Hello, macadamia, multi macadamia munching malt heads. That's better. Nearly didn't get it right there, but I did get it right because I backtracked a little bit to get it right. That's a malt mention, and it's from Retcomania. Thank you, Retcomania. Welcome, malt mates, to Ralfy Review 867 Extras, in which I discuss extra stuff to give you extra information, extra content, so you're extra informed. It's a simple equation. Let's get right into it, right here in the barrel right now. I've started a mini-series on independent bottlings. Where I am, being based in the British Isles, I am spoiled for choice with the range of independent bottlings. There's a lot out there. They are great backbone to the Scotch whisky industry. So basically what happens is the businesses that own distilleries and produce Scotch whisky will generally fill their warehouses with their product and sell it in a number of years' time, a few years or many years' time, as Scotch single malt whisky, official bottlings. Because it's official, because it's coming from the distillery directly, the people bottling it are the owners of the distillery. Occasionally you have a sort of semi-independent bottling permutation, which is where the owners of a distillery will bottle under an independent label that they control and own. And a good example of that is Gordon and MacPhail, who own Benromach Distillery, and Springbank, who own Cadenheads. Yep. So you have an independent bottler owns a distillery with Gordon MacPhail, and you have a distillery owning an independent bottler, as you have with Springbank owning Cadenheads. And there is about 30 to 40, probably more, because there's new independent bottlers popping up fairly regularly now. So it's getting quite a busy scene. And the independent bottlers don't own distilleries. But what they do is they buy either directly from the distillery or from a wholesale broker. These are businesses that you never hear about. They're very quietly lurking in the background. And what they do is they buy from a number of distilleries. They'll keep the barrels and casks that they buy for a while, or alternatively, they just sell them straight back out again to independent bottlers, who will pay a little bit more for these casks than it costs the distillery to produce. But in doing so, they provide a financial money flow to distillers who may have a quiet time of year, for example, just after the new year, January, February, March, always a quieter time for whisky sales. So official bottlers and the distilleries will say, I tell you what, let's just sell 500 casks to the warehouse, a wholesaler. And the wholesaler will say, right, we'll buy the, you know, give us a wee discount on them and we'll buy them in, we'll hold them, we'll put them on our list, and we will selectively sell them to other independent bottlers. The independent bottlers can then say, well, I only want one or two or 10 of casks from this particular distillery, and only want 20 casks from that distillery. So it enables them to buy in small volume. It means that they have diversity within their stock inventory. So it is quite common for an independent bottler to have a tremendous variety of not just Scotch whisky, but other spirits like rum and even bourbons now and again, which can be bottled in Scotland. Yeah, yes, they can. And some really interesting versions too. Doesn't happen very often, but I think we'll see that trend increase over time. So the independent bottlers will have about 50 or 60 or 70, maybe 100 even or more, different named casks from all different sources. Now, sometimes they can use the official distillery name, like Highland Park, for example. If it states on the sales invoice the name Highland Park, that technically is the distillery giving consent for its name to be used. However, should Highland Park use the name Orkney, that tells the independent bottler that they cannot use the name Highland Park because the official bottler wants to keep the name to themselves for provenance and for reputation. It's a bit of a mistake, actually, but many distilleries do it. Lafroig's another example, they do it. This is why very historically there was an independent bottling by Douglas Lang, I believe it was, called Leapfrog, because they weren't allowed to call what they were bottling Lafroig, so they just called it Leapfrog. Likewise, same company, many years ago, they had Talisker, but they weren't allowed to call their product Talisker when they bottled it, so they called it Tactical. Wasn't great quality, very small collectible value, but interesting and eccentric all the same, and that's what you get with Scotch whisky. So you've got all these independent bottlers out there, and some of them will use what they've got to create small batch blends. So they'll incorporate a few casks of, say, North British grain, and they'll make up an interesting and rather eccentric blend of whisky, which they may bottle for a private club, for a special function, for a whisky club somewhere, or if it's a single malt, they might do these to order. They might sell on their casks privately to a whisky club and hold on to it in their warehouse so as to obey the rules and conform to the red tape and bureaucracy that's necessary of having goods which are duty suspended in the UK. And they'll say, rightio, we'll let you know, you let us know when you're interested, we'll let you know what we think, when it's ready, we'll bottle it for you and send it out to you as a private sale. That happens. But most importantly, the real bread and butter for the independent bottlers is when they put on their own independent bottling label and they give some additional information which official bottlings might not necessarily do. And importantly, they provide more of an integrity bottling, so higher strength, natural colour, unchill filtered. Now, not every independent bottler does this. The smart ones do, but some of the big established ones, they sort of split up their range. So with some of the more expensive ones they do, but with some of what they regard as the cheaper ones, which are not that cheap. In fact, they can be more expensive, but I'll come to that in another video shortly. They just say, well, I tell you what, we're just going to have a kind of standard brand. We're going to put it out there as a regular bottling because we've got loads and loads and loads in our warehouse. So we're going to give it a normal bottling. We won't do anything fancy with it, like up the strength and put a declaration on the label that's non-chill filtered and natural colour. So they want to cater to a wider diversity of the market. Small independent bottlers focus on their strengths and what they're good at. They bottle at higher strength, integrity bottling. Here I've got some liquid from James Edie Independent Bottlers. A lovely Scotch mist developing on it. Beautiful whisky, just marked at 90 out of 100. Classic, good quality, independent bottling, which showcases what independent bottlings should be all about. But malt mates, it's a mixed bag. It is a real mixed bag, and I get the question from a lot of times, from a lot of different directions, say, Ralphie, I'm going to get into these independent bottlings, which are the best ones to buy? Now, I would start by saying, not even I can keep up with what's good and what isn't good. We all need to develop our own personal networks, because the variation in quality within independent bottlings is quite shocking. Some are fantastic, great value for money bottlings, and others are, unfortunately, very poor quality. And if you buy them at any price, you're going to be disappointed. It is a lucky dip. What we do to navigate the independent bottlers that are available to us is we take steps to tip the luck more in our favour so that their chances of being profoundly disappointed are reduced. There is no one single independent bottler who consistently puts out great whisky. Previously, a number of years ago, the one independent bottler who did have the bragging rights was Adelphi. Now, Adelphi were doing things old school and they were bottling older whisky. They really looked after the quality of their casks. I'm going to tell you exactly what they did. When they bought whisky, they had the sort of connectivity and the gentleman's contacts within the industry where they could buy better quality casks. And once they'd bought them, they would check them, and if the contents needed recasked, they'd do it. And this is why a few years ago, Adelphi had the enviable reputation of being one of the absolute go-to independent bottlers, where you, on a fairly regular basis, the independent bottlings of whatever single malt distillery was being bottled outperformed the official bottlings, both on terms of calibre, age, quality of content, and price. However, recently, about 10 years ago, Adelphi set up a brand new single malt whisky distillery at a place called Ardnamurchan. I have great expectations for it because the people in charge know what they're doing. They have my confidence. And I look forward to buying a few more bottles of their single malt. But Adelphi started to put the prices up because kicking off a distillery is a very, very expensive business. That even the price of a decent set of copper stills now, whether it be two stills or four stills, you're looking over £1 million for decent ones, you know, the real ones. It's the price of copper, the demand for stills, supply and demand. The waiting time is considerable. The amount of costs in actual building a distillery, the consents, the permissions, the red tape, the logistics, the cost of making whisky has never been higher. The cost of getting good casks for your whisky to mature in, it's never been higher than it is now. It's harder now to get the casks, the calibre of casks than ever before. Supply and demand, big demand, global demand. Restrained supply. I mean, it's easy to buy a jobbing casks, a cobble cask, a reassembled cask. You can pick one up for 50 quid. But see, a decent cask, you're looking at nearer £300 to £500. That's a big difference. Big, big difference. Distilleries now are very, very expensive to get going, and bearing in mind you're not really going to get a return on your investment until after your stock's matured. You're selling it and you've established yourself in the market. So that's one reason why Adelphi bottling prices went up, because supply and demand, and they need the money for the distillery. And this is just at the point where people are now paying a higher and higher premium to get the higher quality of flavour. And it's global. It's not restricted to the UK and some parts of Europe like Italy and Germany. And that's the reality of the situation. So, here's what you need to do. Talk to friends, whisky friends, malt mates. Ask about their experiences. What have they heard? Your specialist retailer, what do they know? If they can't tell you anything about an independent bottler, they can't tell you about what they're specialist in and what they're selling. And therefore, they're not very specialist. They're just generalists. It is not in the interests of a specialist bottler to sell you a bad bottle of independent bottled whisky, because it's just going to put you off going back and giving them further business. So establish a good rapport with them, particularly the ones who know what they're talking about. And bear in mind that for many of these specialist stores, they get sample bottles sent to them. We've got so many single malt whiskies for sale in our latest release. We've got six, for example. Here's six little sample bottles. Would you like to buy some of them? Taste and try before you buy. If they're tasting and trying, they should be in a very good position to tell you whether they're worth it or not. Thirdly, whisky events, whisky festivals, whether they be online Zoom tastings, whether they be podcasts even, listen in, do your groundwork, do your homework. At the moment, it tends to be the distilleries themselves who contribute to podcasts and Zoom meets and all the rest of it. But this is something that independent bottlers should be much more proactive about, to basically to message out what they've got in their portfolio, in stock, in bottle. And if it's good stuff, they should be promoting the good stuff. And if it's not so good, they should be keeping quiet about it. Or even better, not bottling in the first place. Give it a few more years in the cask, or alternatively, recask it to something that's going to work better. And I'm not talking about a wood finish. I'm not talking about 3 months, 6 months, a year. I'm talking about a good 3 or 4 or 5 years so that a fresh cask can re-establish the calibre that's been lost in the inactivity of previous cask. If you're not getting the information that you need before you make your purchasing decision, I'm just going to tell you straight, malt mates, don't buy. Now, you might think, hey, Ralphy, that's not really helping the whisky industry, is it? Well, my response is sometimes the whisky industry doesn't help itself and does not deserve any platitude and sympathy. If you're either going to look after business or you're not, particularly in the way things are changing at the moment, and they're changing fast. So independent bottlers should be out there showcasing, networking, and being honest without the flannel, and be just connecting with people who are going to message realistically and honestly how good something is or how good something isn't, and do it tactfully. My final note is, it may seem a little bit of tough love, but it is far better if the independent bottlers are not routinely bottling top quality stuff. It is better that customers don't buy the product rather than buy it, be disappointed, and then walk away with the following sale and the sale after that and the sale after that to another product. There's all the money that's spent in advertising, and yet a few bad bottles can wipe out a loyal, generous, interested customer for months, if not years. That's the fact of it. I know malt mates who have walked away from whisky completely after 2-3 consecutive purchases of poor quality whisky. It's far better to hold back to up the quality, up the game, bottle when it's ready. And I'm not talking about ready as in standard official bottlings. I'm talking about caliber and quality of smell and taste specifically, because that's something else that's totally unique about independent bottlers, is their ability to present a known recognised flavour in a completely different way that you wouldn't get from official bottlings. And yet in itself, particularly to the experienced palate, is something marvellous and wonderful. I'm Ralphie. Hope you've enjoyed this little extras. I'm going away now to pop the kettle on and have a cup of tea and finish off this rather delightful liquid, which I've been more than happy to recommend in Ralphie Review 867. Haste you back, malt mates.